Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
So I'm gonna order right now, so like, excuse me if I sound like hoarse.
I'm not putting my lips on what y'all to put y'all lips on.
Oh. All right, so I know we was having fun a minute ago, but this is a pretty serious lecture. I'm a little bit nervous, so I need your support. You know what I'm saying? Anytime you feel like you should clap, go ahead and do that. So the title of my lecture is The World Is Yours. Not from a unrealistic, dreamlike stance, but, you know, the world literally is yours. I have a question for you guys, and I need y'all to answer it. Do you believe that you can do anything in the world? Yes or no?
Yes.
All right, settle down. Let's have a whole discussion. If you're answering, you can't hear me?
No.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Whoa. If your answer was yes, perfect. And if it wasn't, my chains?
Jesus.
I don't know how to fix it. But yeah, if your answer was yes, then perfect. If it was no, then I hope to change your point of view by the end of this lecture. We're born and we're children. We have the idea that we can be anything. It's endless possibilities. You know, you believe you can be Superman. You believe you can be a firefighter. You believe you can be a parent until our parents in the real world humble us and give us the idea of reality. You know, we don't believe that we can fly anymore. We don't believe that we can be all these things because, you know, it's just impossible. That's what they tell us. And so then we become practical people with practical dreams and practical jobs, living practical lives. But
I have example. Oh, where'd she go? Actually, switch it there.
So we become practical people with practical jobs, living practical lives until we decide to dream big. There's people out here that I put,
such as Amelia Earhart, Henry Ford,
you know, real trailblazers that changed the way that we exist. You know, they're pilots and making cars and things like that. So imagine telling someone on a horse, like, I'm gonna make a car. They probably laugh at you. You know, it's a new idea, something that they can't dream of. But they didn't allow that to stop them. They followed their dreams and they changed the world. And so my challenge for you guys is to change the world, dream big, and not allow the reality of your current situation, the current reality, to change how you think. Ashley? The story of Demetrius. I am Demetrius Harmon. I was born March 1st.
Okay,
huh? What? Ah! Word. Okay. I'll say.
Not hearing that.
I was born March 1st, 1998. To Darius Harmon and Jennifer Harmon in Detroit, Michigan. Ashley. I have the blood of hard workers. Like, my parents did not believe that there's limits. You know, my mom lost her mother when she was a senior as she was pregnant with my oldest brother. And so that quickly made her realize that she had to become an adult. But my mom didn't allow it to stop her. She had my second brother a year after him. And she began working two jobs, working at a hotel and working at Wendy's to pay for them and, you know, provide for them. But then she realized, like, this is not the life I want to live. I'm better than this. Not saying that working at Wendy's is not a good job, but she knew what she was worth. So she was like, okay, I'm gonna get a low income grant, which is, you know, some people could be ashamed of, admitting that they don't make money, to get a loan with a grant, you know, where they don't have to pay it back to go to college. But she decided she wanted to get her associate's degree. She got the low income grant to get her associates. She got her degree in marketing, which she used to get the job she currently works at now that she's been working at literally since she got her associate's degree. Now she has her master's degree in marketing. My mother also runs her own business. She's an entrepreneur. While she's working her job, while she's being a parent of four healthy, amazing boys,
myself included. She also runs a nonprofit organization where she does a lot of things as far as like giving back to community, whether it's, you know, raising funding for book bags and stuff like that for schools and things like that. And she just got her license to run the nonprofit. My dad, Darius Harmon. My dad lost his father, 12th grade. No, not 12th grade, when he was 12. And so with that dynamic, with him being an only child, at least from only child from his mother, he became the man of the house, you know, which is usually how that becomes. And so his idea of what he should do became providing, you know, working, and everything else got put on the back burner, school included. So my dad didn't graduate from high school. You know, he was, high school to him was just community, hanging out with his friends, doing things like that, but he didn't graduate from high school. My dad talks about it all the time as if he's ashamed of it. You know, he's like, I do good enough for somebody that didn't graduate from high school, but my dad owns his own truck driving business. My dad's an entrepreneur as well. My dad makes 6 figures a year. So, with those type of parents raising me, it was almost destined for me to be the person I am today, to where I don't feel like there's limits. I don't know what limits are. Literally, I don't. Actually. So, I would like, this is a picture of me when I was in second grade. I was on the baseball team, the Detroit Tigers. So second grade year, they're passing around a pamphlet, you know, where they're like, sign up for a baseball team, you get to have all this cool stuff, you get to get team gear, you get to do all these things. I was like, it sounds amazing, you know, because I'm a kid, I'm not thinking of everything I have to do to be on a baseball team. I'm just thinking, okay, I get a t-shirt, I get a hat, you know. So I went home and I begged my parents to let me join a baseball team, and it was like, if you want to do this, you got to stick to it. I'm like, what is there to stick to? I just go out and hit a ball, and then I go home. No. Summer in Michigan is very humid, very, very humid. And I don't know if you guys have ever been to Michigan or ever been to Detroit, but there's like these baseball fields that have really tall grasses. And with me being in second grade, never had did any physical activity, and in the summer we're training, you know, they teach you all these things. One of the things that I picked up the most, and it was really hard for me because I'm really stiff, so when I was younger, they like try to get me to do the, get the ball, like get down and get the ball, and I get it like this. But you gotta like do like this and move. So I was really training and really like paying attention and really working hard. And eventually I became good at it. So you know, by the time the league starts, I'm like, all right, we about to go out there, I'm about to do this. We went out there and lost every single game. Bro, y'all are laughing, bro. We lost every game. Like, never was it close. It was never. At any point did I think, like, oh yeah, I'm about to win this. Every time we went out there, like, from the second game, I was like, all right, bro. All right, okay. And so, with me being in second grade, like I said, I didn't sign up for this. I just, only experience I have with baseball is backyard baseball. So, you know, that's pretty simple. That's pretty, I'm just thinking, I just want to win. As a kid, I just want to win. No kid wants to lose. And no kid wants to lose every single game. So I'm like, why am I doing this, you know? And so towards the end of the league, my parents had their anniversary, so they were going to Jamaica. And so it was my brother's responsibility. I told him, like, make sure Meech goes to his baseball game, because he's going to try not to go, because he's been losing. Yeah, yeah. They really was talking about it, low-key. But so my brother wakes me up at like 10:30, the game is at 12. He's like, do you want to go to the game? Obviously, I said no. You know what we did? When I didn't go, we won. The one game I didn't go to, we won. And I think about that all the time, and I keep that picture on me, because I realize you never know how close you are to succeeding. You know, you never know if you give up. You never know if you give up. I don't know if you guys ever seen that picture where it's this guy mining, and like two guys that got the same distance, but one turned around, and one is like this close to getting the diamond and the payoff. And to me, I think about that all the time, because sometimes it doesn't look like you're gonna succeed. Sometimes it doesn't look like there will be a payoff. But we never know. We tell ourselves that we know, and we plan things to give us a sense of organization, you know, because if we realize how anything could happen, literally anything could happen, this could fall and hit me in the head right now. It could. It could. Anything could happen. Hey! No, anything can happen, and when we think like that, you know, it can be scary, and I think like that a lot of times because I think like my life could end at any point, and that's kind of what pushes me towards depression. But I also think like my life could change at any point, my life could get better at any point, and that gives me hope. So I want to instill that in you guys, and I want you guys to believe in that as well. Ashton? Naruto! Alright, settle down. I used to be a Naruto fanatic from second grade till now, really, realistically. I hide it sometimes, but you know. For you guys who don't know what Naruto is this show, this manga, about this boy who's cursed, essentially, you know. No one likes him because of who he was born to be, you know, who they thought he would be. They pretty much judged him off of stories and things that they thought he would become. But he kept telling people, like, bro, I'm gonna beat Hokage. Hokage is the president, like, essentially, of the village. Imagine the most hated person saying, I'm gonna be the president. That's what he was doing. He was like, I'm gonna do this. Did y'all say Donald Trump? Not the hated person, the most doubted person. No one had a reason to dislike him. He was just alone and everyone judged him for no reason. He just wanted friends. And so every person he encountered, battled, he'd be like, this is what I'm gonna do. I can't lose to you because I have goals. I have things, I have a reason for why I can't lose, you know? And even when it looked like he was about to lose, he didn't. And even when he like was badly injured, he's in the hospital bed, looking like he's about to die, like, bro, I'm gonna beat Hokage. Everybody looking at him like, what are you talking about? And you know what he did at the end of the show? He became the Hokage. He'd been talking about being Hokage the whole show. And he did it. So with me being a young, impressionable child, it taught me optimism. It taught me the power of it, you know? If I tell you, you can't tell me what I'm gonna do. You can't tell me who I'm gonna be. I'm gonna tell you, and you either have to believe me or I'm gonna make you believe me. I like that snap. But it taught me that. It showed me, and I didn't realize it as I was reading it, but now I look back on it, it's just like, I have the same optimism and fire in my heart as Naruto. Everything starts from your mindset, you know, what you believe in, who you believe you can be. If you tell yourself that you can't do it, then how will you ever do it? If you tell yourself, I can't do this, I won't do this, then it won't happen. If you just start by believing in yourself and making people believe in you, regardless if they do or not, then that's when it starts. I have a video from Naruto. It's about this guy named Rock Lee. He's a character. He's a character in Naruto. He doesn't have any special God-given ability in the Naruto world. He just worked really hard. He worked 100 times harder than everybody. And when he wanted to give up, he didn't. And there was a point in time when he was fighting this guy who just seemed like he was gonna beat everybody. He was gonna kill everybody. And nobody expected this person who has no God-given talent, quote unquote, to be the one to defeat him, and he did. So Ashley?
Okay, I'm going to flip. When people think so, we need to believe that if I just train harder than Nikki, 2 or 3 times harder, I would make myself strong enough. But now, I am not so sure. I do not know if I will ever be able to work hard enough to be real talent. That is why I'm always taking up Nikki. I keep thinking all of my efforts will pay off, but it is always the same. I have no match for it at all. Every time we have a ninja mission, my legs begin shaking. I do not know if I can take it. Sometimes it seems like the whole thing is pointless. Like I'm a loser and I will always be a loser. I do not know what to do.
You are right. All the effort is pointless if you don't believe in yourself. You know, Lee, we're a lot alike, you and I.
You mean eyebrows?
No, I don't mean our eyebrows. You see, I was a loser too once.
What? You were a loser?
Oh, yes indeed. But I made myself the equal of any ninja, even Kakashi. And I did it through effort. You say you want to show the world you can be a splendid ninja, even if you don't have all the gifts that others are blessed with. That's your ninja way, right? Well, I think that's a fine goal. As fine a goal as I've ever heard, and one worth sticking to. Don't let anything steer you off the path you've drawn for yourself. Forge ahead to the end. Stick to it, baby. Make me proud. Be everything you can be. Will you do that for me, Lee?
Yes, sir.
How hard are you willing to work to make it work? Like realistically, you know, we have these goals, we have these dreams, but they're just dreams until you put the work in for it, until you give up something, until you're willing to give up everything for them. I don't know if you guys know of my story, how I became who I am, but I've been doing social media. I've been doing my clothing brand since 7th grade. I've been doing social media since 8th. This year and the year before is just when I started to see like real fruits, you know, when I really started to feel like, okay, I'm making progress. You know, I always have had followers, I've always had this, but where I really can do this, I can do the things that I want. And it's not just followers for my social media, it's followers and people who appreciate me as a person. But I had to give up things along the way. 11th grade year, I had to make it work. I had to make what I wanted to do work, or I couldn't do anything else. I had to make it work because I didn't have another choice. I was in 11th grade. I was considered a 10th grader because I had missing credits. So I didn't take the ACT. I took my SAT 12th grade year. And I had a lot of things and people depending upon me, and I didn't know what I was doing with my life. I never applied to any college. I didn't look at any college. It was in school talking about college. And I'm like, I don't know, dog. But it's one thing to know I don't want to go to college. It's another thing to know what I want to do instead. And at the time, I didn't know what I wanted to do. You know, I was doing the videos. It's like, I can't do videos for the rest of my life. I would love to, but I can't be a 30-year-old man with a child. Like, yeah, this is what I'm doing. I wanted to have something, not realistic, something tangible, something that I could be proud of. Not saying I'm not proud of the videos, but something that I could expand upon, which is this. You know, back in 11th grade year, I was like, I want to talk to students, I want to share my story with people because I feel like I have a story that deserves to be heard. And so fast forward to now, I'm doing it, but it started with a plan. With the hoodies, 9th grade year, 8th grade year. 8th grade year, I sold and made $10,000 a month selling hoodies. 9th grade year, nothing. I blew through all the money, I lost all the money. I spent it on Jordans. I couldn't even tell you where all that money went. I was in 8th grade. Why does an 8th grader have that amount of money? 10th grade year, same thing, no sales realistically. You know, not a large amount of maybe like 30 hoodies, 30 hats, things like that. So, but not something that I could really live off of. 11th grade year, it was like, bet, I gotta make this shit work. So what can I do to make this work? So I didn't have the same presence I do now as far as selling apparel. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna make city merch. I'm gonna make merch that's prideful for Detroit. So if I make merch that's prideful for Detroit, who's gonna buy it? People in Detroit. So I can't put it on my website. There's people in the city. Why do people in the city want to order from somebody in the city? You know, why would they pay for shipping? So I would literally come home from school at 2 p.m. Get my brother. By 3 p.m. we on the road. You feel me? We're going to the east side of Detroit, which is 40 minutes away from my house. I didn't have a wholesale distributor at the time, so I would go to Target and get just blank hoodies, you know, like the merino hoodies, and just print on them. I ask people, I'd be like, you got Jordans? What colorway is that? You feel me? I can make a hoodie for that colorway. And I sell it to them, you know, but I wasn't making too much money because I got about a hoodie for like $20. I got paid like $15 for the printing. It's $35 a month. I'm not gonna charge somebody $50 because they're not gonna pay that. They don't see value in my clothing brand yet. So I'm charging like $45, I'm making $10 to do all of that. But realistically, I'm not making money at all. I'm putting gas in my tank. I gotta eat, you know, so I was just breaking even every day. But we would do that every day. We would drive to go get the hoodies, go to the mall, you know, wait in the meantime, waiting for them to make the hoodies, And then we'd go deliver them. Like, I literally was hand delivering hoodies. Because of what else was I gonna do? Sit at home, not do anything? Sit at home, do my homework. I didn't wanna do my homework. So I had to do this, you know, and I had to, it wasn't about the financial, it was just about the feeling of doing something, of working towards something, even if I wasn't getting a payoff financially, I felt like I was working towards something. And I feel like I've accomplished that now. You know, I got the hoodies, I got the new matter merch, I got everything doing that, but I gave up so much to make it work. And you have to, you can't just expect things to happen. And so, in 11th grade year, my aunt passed away. In December, she passed away. And when she passed away, I remembered. I'll tell y'all a story. I didn't plan to tell y'all the whole story. So I go upstairs, my mom, Party Next Door's having a concert. I wanna go to the Party Next Door concert. She's like, all right, pull it up. And so she comes, but she's in the house and she's kind of like not paying attention to anything I'm talking about. She's just at the table and she's very distant. So my brother's like, what's wrong? So my auntie had a heart condition, you know, so her heart failed a lot of times and she had a stroke. And so she was like, your aunt heart failed again. She's in the hospital. She collapsed, she had a stroke. And that happens a lot of times. She had a pacemaker, you know, sometimes the heart would stop. And I'm kind of just used to it, but it's like, it was just an eerie feeling. It was weird. It was just weird. I kind of knew at the time. But I'm making pork chops, you feel me? I'm trying to keep my mood up. Cause I'm not trying to think about my auntie passing. And so, go downstairs, I pull the Party Next Door tickets up, come back upstairs, making pork chops, trying to talk to my mama. And she not really paying attention to what I'm talking about. She's kind of real like, all right, bro. And so, she's sitting at the table. I'm flipping the pork chop, phone ring. Everything goes silent. I freeze, my brother freeze, my mom answers the phone. And she picks up the phone and she doesn't say anything. I don't hear what's said. I just know she threw her phone and screamed. And we knew, you know, we knew at that moment that she was gone. And it was hard to accept because I kept putting off seeing my aunt. You know, she lived in California, so I kept being like, you know, I can just go to California one time. I'm not thinking that I could lose her, you know. I didn't see my aunt while I was a teenager. I think the last time I saw my aunt was like sixth grade year. And it was just, in that moment, you know, I'm lost. I don't wanna eat, I don't wanna do nothing. 2014, Forest Hills just dropped. So, I go in the shower. I shower downstairs. No one uses the shower downstairs. Dante can tell you no one uses the shower downstairs. But it's the basement is dark, you know? There's no one can bother me. So I go downstairs, put on the intro of Forest Hills Drive on loop. You know, do you wanna be happy? And so, I'm just in the shower, I'm sitting on the floor in the shower fucking crying, bawling my eyes out. 3 days after that, I'm supposed to be hosting a party. I'm supposed to be hosting my first party. How can I act happy? How can I get other people happy if I'm not? And so I was like, I'm gonna just cancel it. And then the day before I was gonna cancel it, I was like, nah, I wanna be the person that she believed I could grow to be. You know, my aunt used to talk about me all the time. When she found out I was doing the videos and stuff like that, she's like, oh, that's my baby. I'm your number one fan. You know, she just posted all this stuff. And, like, she'd post about how people know me. And she's like, my baby really famous. You know, and it's like, I wasn't, realistically compared to now, I wasn't nothing. You know, I wasn't where I could have been. But I felt like I needed to do that for her. Which brings me into my next thing. You gotta figure out your why. You know, all this stuff is pointless. All of this work, being in school, studying, is pointless. You're gonna lose gas, you're gonna stop. If you don't know what your drive is, if you don't know why you're doing it, why you're in college, regardless if it's for you, for your future, for your parents, whatever it is, you gotta know why you do it. Ashley?
This jab, Creed looks to land one big shot. Yes!
Come on, baby.
Stage!
Creed just got up like a man possessed. He was down but not out. Penland thinks he's celebrating a knockout.
Hey, get him!
But the referee is dusting Creed's gloves. Creed beats the count, and the action
begins again.
That's the heart of a champion. He has his daddy's heart, I'll tell you that much.
Daddy, be ready.
Hey, more work to do for Conlon. Body shot. Body shot. Trying to set Creed up one more time.
So, I hope one of that was to show his body, you know what I'm saying? When he's, as a boxer, you feel me? You have to train for a fight for someone that you have never faced before. You have to prepare for an obstacle that you never have seen, you know? So you go in there with a game plan, you feel me? You go in there like, all right, I'm gonna hit him with the right, then we hit him with the right, I'm gonna fall to my left, and I'm gonna hit him with the left, and I'm gonna jab him. But then what happens when you go in there, and boom, you get hit, boom, you get hit. Next thing you know, you're on the floor. That's what happened with life. You have a game plan of, I'm gonna get to college, and I'ma just study, and I'ma just knock these grades out, it's gonna be a piece of cake, and then you get here, you feel me? Then you get here, you feel me, it's all the stress from all your schoolwork, you know, and then depression hit, the anxiety hit, you feel me, you got 5 papers due in one day, and you got all this stuff going on, and how do you get back up? How do you get up when you're knocked down? And that's why I say you need your why. But not just for being able to stay up when you're up, but to get back up when you're knocked down. My why and the things, the reason I work so hard as I do is because I want to be an active father in my children's lives when I finally do have them. My dad worked so much. My dad is a truck driver, like I said, so he literally worked from day to night. You feel me? He'd wake up at 5 a.m., get home at like 6 p.m. But you know, you get home at 6 p.m. and you gotta shower, you gotta eat, poop, whatever you gotta do. You feel me? By the time he's ready to interact with us, I gotta go to sleep. So I didn't really have much time to interact with my dad. I know that bothered him that he didn't get to be involved with so many things as he could, but you know, providing was a big focus on him. So now I work so hard now while I don't have children. So when I do have them, I can just be like, all right, oh, you wanna go to Disneyland? All right, we can go to Disneyland, you know, and I don't have to work, and work isn't the priority. I think about my friends who believe in me more than I believe in myself sometimes. I don't know if you guys know who Angelo is. You guys know who Dope Island is?
Yes. Yes.
So, Angelo's been my best friend since 8th grade. And he tells me all the time, like, you know, whenever you say you're gonna do something, you do it. Whenever you say something's gonna happen, it happens. And I just never question you when you tell me something. I just always just believe in it. And I believe in you, you know what I'm saying? And sometimes like when I was preparing for this, when I was preparing for if you see the thing, I was talking about like, what if nobody show, what if it doesn't go well? He was just like, what you saying? You scared? You nervous? What you think, you're not gonna be good like you always are? You feel me? And you pick me back up. Or Dante, you feel me? Dante took me backstage a couple minutes ago. Dante's him. This is Dante. Dante took me backstage and he was like, you know, we all proud of you. Not just me, Roman, your friends, but everybody, your aunt, everybody. And I just feel like I got a duty to not let them down. Almost, you know. I feel like everything that they didn't put to making my dreams come true, it'd be a disservice to them to let them down. 11th grade year, my reasoning, my drive was, I thought my girlfriend was pregnant. Yo, I like this was boring, yo. So this is my SAT score. That's horrible, huh? All right now, set it down. Set it down now. How y'all gonna laugh at me saying settle down, but not settle down? Oh. Hey,
got limited time. I fell asleep on SAT. Fell asleep in math. Fell asleep in English. I remember I talked to someone recently, and it was like the teacher was like, I don't know what to do. Do I wake them up? I don't know. Because I was asleep throughout the most of the part, because by then I already gave up on high school. I gave up on college.
Ashley?
This is my girlfriend, my ex-girlfriend. But we dated from like 6th grade to 12th grade.
As you can see, I used to keep that Polaroid in my wallet. You see it says, why I do it all.
You know, so every time I lost faith or I lost hope or I was like, why am I doing all this? Why am I working so hard? It brought me back. It gave me focus. And like I said, I thought she was pregnant. So it was like, not only is she dependent upon me, that's the kind of life I'm about to bring into this world. So I gotta work hard, you feel me? I gotta do whatever I can do to make it work. And that's when I was doing the hoodies. That's when I was dropping off and delivering the hoodies. So I grew up and I was like, all right, fuck this. These hoodies ain't cutting it. I'm just breaking even every day. So I gotta get a real job. Which brings me to working at Kroger at Little Caesars. The worst days of my life. I don't know if you guys know anyone that works at Kroger, but, oh, you work at Kroger. All right, now. The bagger, I was a bagger. And being a bagger, you gotta do everything nobody wanna do. It's not, you know, when you think of a bagger, you just think, oh, they just bag groceries. No, we gotta mop up, we gotta clean the bathrooms. If there's a spill, if there's a throw up, we gotta clean that up. We gotta do the carts, regardless if it's snow outside or if it's hot outside. The bottle room, you know, you do a little deposit. It's a big old thing, right? And people be leaving juice in their bottles. So then we gotta take the bottle and then our hands get sticky. Everything nobody wanna do, we gotta do. Which I didn't sign up for, but I was like, all right, bro, I don't wanna do this. But, like I said, I have somebody that depends upon me. I have lives that need me. It was hard. Cause imagine working for yourself since seventh grade to now having to take orders. I was like, all right, bro, this ain't it. And I'm the youngest brother, so I have a problem with authority. You know, I'm always like, all right, no, you ain't gonna tell me what to do. And so that's where I clash heads a lot of times working at Kroger. But I had to do it. You know, I had to. I had no other choice because what I wanted to do and the dreams I had wasn't cutting it. But working at Kroger showed me, okay, bro. Once I quit, I was like, okay, we ain't going back to that. Cannot go back to that, so we have to make this shit work. It was all right, we gotta make this shit work, but now I was like, all right, we for sure gotta make this shit work, because that's ass. Every single job at Kroger was horrible, regardless if it was cashier or if it was a person telling me what to do. Nobody liked their job. No one likes having a job at Kroger. So then fast forward to the end of 11th grade year, beginning of 12th. I started working at Little Caesars. It was different working at Little Caesars because I didn't necessarily need the job financially. I needed the job because if you had a job in high school, you had to leave school early. So I was like, all right, bro, whatever, rock it, you feel me? But with Little Caesars, it was just a strain on my mental health, as you can see. Oh, you died sad. He's taking a picture of me. I'm like, bro, I don't. Help me. You know, you know the people who do the little thing outside? Nigga, they have me doing that. Why? In the cold, too. Oh, my God. But my biggest problem working with Little Caesars is my manager. My manager is one of those people who. You ever, somebody ever say a joke to you, and it's not, it's like evil spirited. Yeah. And then you like you call them out on it. They're like, no, I was just joking. Why you gotta be so sensitive? But it's like, no, you meant that. But if I didn't call you out on it, you wouldn't have said nothing. But you put it in a joke so you can guise how you really feel under a joke because you're scared to be truthful. He was like that. One time, this girl I was working with, coworker, she's like, give me your like info so I can buy. I want to buy a shirt. You know what I'm saying? I want to support this nigga. Come out of like, imagine somebody just come from back there like, oh, Meech ain't got a clothing brand. He just print on shirts. Nigga, what? What do you want me to do? Get a cotton gin and make the cotton, the shirt for trash. And so from there, we just started clashing heads. We always clash heads, you know, like, the phone would ring, and I would walk to the phone, and he'd be like, oh, you're not moving with enough effort. I need to see more effort. I'm like, nigga, pay me better. and that's just the reality of the situation because, like I said, I'm used to not working for someone. I know the value of myself. I know what I'm valued. I'm not, $750 not enough for me to be doing all of this. $750, dog. I'm sorry. But the main thing I want to take from that is, even though he's my boss, I defended myself against him. You know, I defended my dreams. I defended the things that I believed in and I cared about. You know, he's like, oh, you got clothing, bro. I'm like, nigga, I do. What do you got? I could have talked about him. You know, I could have talked about the fact I'm working for you and I make more money than you. But money isn't the basis of what I care about. It is for him, you know. But defend your dreams, regardless of what people say to you, regardless of what people have to say about your dreams, whether they feel like they're too big, too small, or realistic, unrealistic. People only can dream as far as they believe they can go. You know, people only can see you going as far as they see themselves going. And so since he didn't dream big enough, he didn't believe I could do the things I was doing. Ha! So, moving to California. These are my people. This is Shabit Moore. This is Yara Shahid. Zoli Griggs. You know,
I don't know why I can't remember his name right now. I'm so sad. Because I love him.
It's okay.
But I'm on stage and I'm nervous.
But yeah, so the first day I moved to California, I met them. But that's not the point. Everything about moving to California was planned. I feel like it just seemed like, oh yeah, this is a dude that make videos, and now he moved to California, and I can do that too. I can just start doing YouTube videos and move to California. No, everything was planned. You know, I was saving money from the moment I thought my girlfriend was pregnant until then. Saving every ounce for us, then we broke up, you know? So then it's like, oh, I just got money. But I ain't gonna plan, because at the time it was just like, I'm gonna just provide, bro. Like, whatever we gotta do, I'm gonna make it do. You know what I'm saying? But then, so I'm like, what do I want to do? 12th grade year, I still didn't know what I wanted to do. So I got scared, and out of fear, I was like, shit, I'm gonna move to California and make it work. I'm gonna be an actor, you know? At the time, I don't think I actually really wanted to be an actor. I was just like, this is what I'm good at. I make videos, so I just be an actor. And so I was planning all these things out of fear of not doing something. I never want to feel complacent, I suppose. I never want to feel like I'm not doing something because I don't have the same backing. I knew I wasn't going to college. I knew I was behind in that world, in the world of education. I was behind because my grades wasn't going to get me in no good school. You feel me? I graduated like a 1.7. That's horrible. But after I moved to California, I flew back to Detroit literally like every chance I got. I moved to California December 4th. I came back like December 12th, you feel me? And then I left. I came back to California for New Year's Eve for Disney World. Then I came right back and was back for most of January. Then I left, and I came right back for Valentine's Day. And I left, and I came right back for my birthday, which is March 1st. Then I left, and I came right back for my dad's birthday. You know, I kept finding every reason to come back because home was my comfort zone, you know, it was, California was me stepping out of that box, stepping out of my comfort zone and trying to do something different. And I'm a really picky eater, and I put me being a picky eater on me being stuck in my comfort zone. I'm scared of new things. I'm scared of trying something and failing, you know? So I was just like, all right, I'm moving to California, but I'm just keep coming back. I'm gonna just say I moved to California. So I feel like I did something. I feel like I made an accomplishment, but I really wasn't working towards the things that I did. Moved to California for it. But it took me 9 months to join a class, an acting class, because I was just scared. I was like, what if I don't do good? What if I fail? Then I went to the class. I don't know if you guys know who Richard Lawson is. Richard Lawson is Beyonce's stepfather. And so he was like, when we did our exercise, he was like, you're a natural actor. You know, there's certain things you gotta work on, but you're natural at this. And I don't know why I doubted myself for that long. And I feel like we all do that. We all are scared to take the first step. But once you put the first foot in front of the other, then naturally the other one has to follow. And that's all it takes. The first step is the hardest one to take. So, bring it all together. the Umatta merch. I started making the Umatta merch at the end of my senior year because I was very suicidal, I was very depressed. Because like I said, I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. I never really knew what I wanted to do in my life. I still kind of don't know what I want to do in my life. But specifically senior year, because everyone's going places. Everyone's, I'm going to this school, I'm going here, and I'm about to do this, and I'm going to be this. And when I turn 30, I'm going to have this. And I'm like, dog, I don't know what the fuck I'm doing, you know? And so I was just writing out self-affirmations. I was writing out, you know, your mental health matters, your career matters, your skin tone matters, your nose matters, like everything I was insecure about. And then when I looked at it, I was like, you matter. It's an encompassment of me. You matter. And so I made these shirts. Feel me? I have that shirt on. I made it. I started trying to sell them. I did the first drop. Shirts sold horribly. So like 15 shirts. I had like 200,000 followers. I was like, what? What am I doing wrong? This is good stuff. You know, I'm just trying to make people feel good. Like, I want to make myself feel good. And so it just seemed like nobody cared. And for the first time ever with my clothing brand, I gave up. I was like, all right, bro. I guess this ain't it. This ain't cutting it. I got to go back to the drawing board. I got to go back to making these relatable videos. And so I just hung it up for like a year. You know, I didn't touch designing. I didn't touch t-shirts. I didn't do anything. I just gave up because I was like, this doesn't work. People don't care about this. And then I don't know what gave me the spark to start up again, but I needed comfort. You know, and I don't like t-shirts. Even right now, I feel weird because I don't got my arms covered. I like having my arms covered. I like hoodies. They feel like a hug. They feel like security, you know? They feel like safety. So I was like, I'm gonna make these hoodies. And I was like, ugh. I hate gilded hoodies because they're thin. You know, a hug don't feel like a gilded hoodie. You know, I need something that feel like a hug. So I started doing research and I started just looking at different type of hoodies, like heavy hoodies, all that stuff. And then I finally found a brand that I work with now and I just start designing again. You know, I started having that drive to do the same things I was doing before. But then so as I'm working and I'm doing all these things, you know, I come back home, it's October, close to, Halloween, I got the date of when I'm gonna release them, which was November 17th, 2017. And one day I woke up, my mom texted the group chat, and she was like, your uncle on life support. And this isn't my blood uncle, this is my mom, my dad's best friend. But he's always been in my life, you know? He's always been like that person. That if you didn't tell me that wasn't my uncle, I wouldn't have known, you know? And he was diabetic. He just had so many struggles with his health. But then again, you know, like I said, by my aunt, it was one of those things where I'm like, this can't happen. This is, I'm not gonna lose him. You know what I'm saying? Then I go to the hospital, and I walk in the room, and I see my uncle with tubes in his mouth, you know, tubes up his nose, his eyes are rolling in the back of his head. I touched his hand and I could feel his soul gone. He was already gone when I seen him. And it shook me to my core. I had nightmares about it. You know, I just didn't feel certain about life anymore. You know, I was back in that same rut of like, oh, what's the point of living if we're just gonna die? So then, to make it worse, you know, he's still on life support. He's not gone yet, but in my mind, he's gone. I feel it, you know. I go back to California. For the first time, I moved in. Like, when I moved out, I moved in with five different people. But November 1st, me and Angelo moved into the apartment we have now. But Angelo didn't move out to California yet. So I'm just in that big-ass apartment by myself with my uncle on life support. So many things going on back home, but I'm in California by myself for the first time ever. Like I said, I'm a son. I have three brothers, parents. Both my parents was in the house, so it's five people in the house all the time. I've never been alone. I've never had to deal with being alone, legitimately, you know. If I ever need something, I could go and get it from someone in that same house. And so I became extremely depressed and suicidal again. And then, you know, one of the days I'm Ubering to my friend's house. I go on Facebook, and I see RIP Uncle Reg. No one told me that he passed away. I found out on Facebook. And again, I'm dealing with that shit alone. You know what I'm saying? I'm dealing with all these things alone. I'm just angry. I'm mad at the world and I'm scared. And so like, I didn't even want to drop the hoodies anymore. I was like, this shit is pointless. You know, why am I doing any of this? But again, I don't know what sparked it, you know? Had with my aunt and me hosting that party, I just felt like I had to do it in his honor. So I was like, post the hoodies. Everybody excited about the hoodies, but I'm like, I don't mean shit because they was excited about the shirts. I dropped the hoodies and I'm nervous because I ain't dropped none in a year. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, let me not look at it. So I go to Best Buy, give me a speaker because it's a new house, so I don't got nothing. You feel me? I'm just in the house alone with my thoughts and playing music off my speaker. So playing music off my phone speaker. Get the speaker. I turn my phone to undisturbed because I usually get the notifications of every sale. Like every time a sale comes through, it pops up on my phone. So I made it to where nothing pops up on my lock screen. So I'm just scared to look. I'm like, ah, this shit's horrible. You know what I'm saying? So I start playing music and I check. I sold 600 in 40 minutes compared to selling 15 in a week. And so for me, that meant that was all the reassurance I needed. I needed to keep going. That I should keep going, you know? I believe that my uncle's spirit, my uncle's heart is the reason I kept going, the reason why I did so well, because it had to be a sign. It had to be, you know, it had to be that. Because if I gave up, I wouldn't have been where I am right now.
Next.
This is my conclusion. With the last moments of my lecture, I just want to say that there's no difference between me and you guys. You know, I'm 20. We're peers. There's no difference between what I can do and what you guys can do. I just don't want to fail. You know, y'all don't got to make videos like me. Y'all don't got to talk about like me, but I believe y'all can do whatever y'all want. That's why y'all here, isn't it?
Yeah.
Cause y'all got goals, y'all got dreams. Yeah. Just like I do, you feel me? And y'all gonna achieve them. It's not a race, there's no comparison. Comparison is the thief of joy. You know, when you start to compare yourself, you start to look over like, oh wow. Oh yeah, he got it, oh, he got that, I gotta get that too. You know what I'm saying? You stop focusing on what you really want and what you really wanna do with this life. So I urge you guys not to compare yourselves to me, to anyone else. Stop looking on Instagram for validation of where you should be in life, because it's 13-year-olds with $1 million, that's crazy. You feel me? But as long as you're happy with the life you live and the life you lead in, that's all that really matters. Live for yourself and don't place your happiness into material things. You feel me? Like, it don't matter. None of that shit matters, realistically. We just told it does. Money only matters because they put value on it. But if you choose to find value in all these other things, like quality time with your family, you know what I'm saying? Quality time with your friends, everything. Life, just seeing a tree, you feel me? Seeing the leaves change, shit like that. And I promise it's gonna be so much easier to smile every day. Because when you just working to get money and get material things, it's fleeting, you know? You're like, okay, I got this. All right, what am I getting next? There's always something to get, but when you just live your life and appreciate it as it goes, you're gonna forever be happy. You know, it's gonna be moments where it look like you ain't gonna ever get out that pit, but I believe in yin and yang, you know, darkness and light, and you can't know what light is without darkness. You know what I'm saying? You need those bad days so you can appreciate the good ones. So, I appreciate you guys for coming.
Sometimes I think better when I'm lit, so go on and light it, roll it up.
You gotta get people saying I smell good.
I'm gonna make sure I'm gonna have somebody come up to you and say you stink.
Saying sky's the limit, how bitch I'm moonwalking. And my middle name Michael Ho. Success is my idol and being broke is my rival. But it's cool cause I got the title, ho. See, I just want my fantasies in real life. You got everything, tell me what it feel like. Motherfuck the
rock.
What's that playing? What's that music?
I don't know.
Pull up in that demon. Oh,
fraud.
Looking like I still do fraud.
Radio, if I can't hear mine, to get all wrong, niggas, more airtime than airlines. Is you feeling me? If not, you feel my energy. See, I know I'ma make it, but even if I don't feel bad. Cause honestly, all these times that I had, those will be the best memories. Remember me. These will be the best memories.